Hello, everyone. This episode is actually a remastering of an older episode. And you might be wondering, well, why am I doing this? Well, it's a very popular episode that I did back when I was not as skilled at making videos as I am now. So I've decided to update it to correct problems and improve the information provided. Okay, first, let's cover all the different parts that you'll need to replicate this experiment. And you'll need a breadboard to build the circuit on, a 7-segment display, preferably one with two or more digits, a PIC microcontroller to control the 7-segment display, 8 390 ohm resistors, one 0.1 microfarad capacitor, 120 picofarad capacitor, one 3.3K ohm resistor, one 1 meg ohm resistor, wire to make all the connections, MPLAB 8 or MPLAB X, and a PIC kit 2 or a PIC kit 3. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and build up my circuit, so let's go ahead and jump to the end of that. This IC here is the PIC 16F54. I'm using this MCU because that's the MCU I used in the original video. Over here is the 7-segment display. The resistors here control the flow of current from the PIC to the LED display. This resistor ties MClear high. This prevents the microcontroller from resetting when we're trying to run our program. The bypass capacitor, located here, keeps the microcontroller stable and prevents power fluctuations from causing the MCU to crash, or even reset. The last thing is the RC circuit. This is a simple circuit that most baseline PIC microcontrollers can use to generate a clock signal. And to help you along, here's a schematic of the circuit used in this video. Now that we have the circuit ready to go, let's get down to writing the code to run the display. First up, let's create the project. Now, find the PIC 16F54 in the drop-down list and select it as the MCU we'll be using. Click Next. Now select the assembly language compiler. Click Next. Select the directory where you wish to store the project, and let's name the project 1D7SLED. Click Save. Now we need to add some files to the project. To do this, find where your template files are stored and select the one labeled 16F54.lkr and click Add. Next up is the include file, so find the file named p165x.inc. Select it and then click Add. Click Next. Now click Finish. Next we'll be asked to save the workspace, so just click Save. Okay, now let's add another template file to the project. This will be the file we are actually going to edit. Find and select the file named 16F54TMPO and open the file. Now that we have it open, we need to save it as a new file in the directory where our project is located. And let's call it 1D7SF54. Now that we have the template file saved, we want to remove the original template file from our project and add in the file we are going to actually be editing. Open up the file. There's a lot to take in here if you haven't done any assembly language programming before. So let's start with the underscore config line and what these directives mean. Underscore CP underscore off means that the code protect will be off. When this is on, it prevents the code inside the PIC from being read out of the chip. This is a security measure to protect your hard work. underscore WT underscore off means the watchdog timer is off, which for this video tutorial is what we want. Underscore RC underscore OSC tells the compiler that we are using a resistor capacitor circuit to generate the clock signal for the MCU. This next section holds all our variable definitions. Right now we just have temp demo code contained in the template. The temp var udata is the name of the variable block. Since we'll be changing things here, I'm going to go ahead and rename the block to 7 underscore seg. The res1 directive tells the compiler to reserve one memory location for the variable, and that we don't care where in memory that reserve space will be. For now, I'm going to go ahead and set up three different variables. The first one will be display underscore counter. We'll use this variable to keep track of our current count. Display underscore temp. We'll use this variable for temporary storage. Display underscore loop. We'll use this variable for a time-killing routine we'll write later. Now let's move down to the start label, which is where the PIC will begin executing code and where we'll begin writing the code that will configure the PIC. These lines here clear the contents of all of our variables, basically setting them to all equals zero. This command clears the working register. And this line here configures port B to be an output. Now I'm going to insert a subroutine I built for this type of display. This routine's name is 7seg underscore lookup. What this routine does is take a number that is passed to it, convert it to appropriate binary code needed to show that number on the 7-segment display, and then return that code to the routine that called 7seg lookup. Now for the main code, which is the routine that will control the 7-segment display. First, we need to write a command to copy the contents of display counter to W. Next, we need to convert the value of W to the displayable binary code, so we call 7seg lookup. Now we can move that value to port B so that the display will light up. Next, let's increment the counter so that the next value we show on the display will be the next higher number. And finally, this goto command will loop us around to repeat the process. Looking good so far. But we have a problem that we need to fix. When 7seg lookup is called, W can contain a value that is greater than 15, or 0x0f in hex. That means that the 7seg lookup routine will jump outside the bounds of the table and begin executing code outside the bounds of our program. This is bad. This is very bad, and we need to fix it before we even try to run this program. To fix this, we just need to filter out the upper four bits in W before calling 7seg lookup. So let's add a command to move 0f into W and then AND that value with display counter. This has the effect of only allowing the lower four bits into W. Now we can call 7seg lookup and we won't go outside the bounds of the table. We're almost ready, but I need to add a time-killing routine to slow down the display. If we didn't do this, the display would change so fast that we wouldn't be able to see the individual numbers. Now let's compile the code. Unfortunately, MPLAB 8 can't program the PIC 16F54 directly. So I'm going to use the standalone programmer that comes with the PIC Kit 2 to program the F54. To do this, first make sure the PIC 16F54 is erased. Then click on File and open the compiled hex file that we just created when we compiled our code. Then click on Program. Okay, so the routine we added to slow down the counting process isn't enough. We are still counting so fast that we can't see the individual numbers. So we'll need to modify the code and slow the counting process down even further. So let's add some code to our delay routine. Now we have two loops, an inner loop and an outer loop. The inner loop will execute 256 times, and the outer loop will execute the inner loop 256 times. So we have really slowed the counting process down at this point. Now let's compile the program. Erase the PIC 16F54 and program the PIC. There we go. That's fantastic. Now the counting is much slower and we can see individual numbers appearing on the display. There you have it. Now you have a working example of how to show information on a 7-segment display. That's it for this video, but I am also going to be remaking the part 2 to this where we did the multiplexing. So you can look forward to that showing up here in a few weeks. Thanks for watching, take care, and be sure to rate, comment, and subscribe. Thank you.